Welcome everyone to our Wednesday devotional and Bible study time. I am glad that you are with us. I invite you to turn your Bibles to Hebrews chapter number 11, Hebrews 11, and then we'll go back to the Old Testament, to the book of Genesis. We have been studying some heroes of the faith as identified in Hebrews chapter number 11, and we've been noticing how, as Christians, you and I are called to live by faith. And one of the things we've noticed is that these men and women who are considered heroes of the faith, they certainly were not perfect, but they were faithful. And I know that that my preparation for tonight's lesson has been an encouragement to me, and I hope it will be an encouragement to you. Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 11, as we talk tonight about Sarah. By faith, Sarah herself also received strength to conceive seed, and she bore a child when she was past the age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead, were born as many as the stars of the sky in multitude, innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore. That original promise given to Abraham in Genesis chapter number 12 about being the father of many nations, and Abraham's wife Sarah, originally Abram and Sarai. By the time the Lord was ready to fulfill that promise, Abraham and Sarah, but there was an opportunity for this couple, Abraham and Sarah, to demonstrate much faith in the Lord. And thankfully, Sarah is recognized here along with Abraham as an awesome couple, as an awesome husband-wife team who kept the faith. But it wasn't a perfect faith. It was a faith that was filled with some ups and downs, and some behaviors that were certainly not a reflection of complete faith, but there were certainly some back and forth, some ups and downs. But in the end, Sarah was found to be faithful. Go with me, if you will, back to the Old Testament, to the book of Genesis, and I'm going to point out a few passages, and I'll try to hit some highlights, and hopefully you'll take some time to go back and study these in fuller detail. You may recall in Genesis chapter number 12 that the original promise is given. That's verses 1 through 3. And so the problem was Abraham and Sarah were not spring chickens. I think 35 and older these days is considered a high-risk pregnancy. But when you're in your 90s, there's certainly, it's not a high-risk pregnancy. It's a no-risk pregnancy. But this was what was going on. And so in Genesis chapter 16, there is the account with Sarai and Hagar. Hagar was one of the maidservants, and Sarah was trying to figure out exactly how all of this was going to go about, knowing that she says in verse number 2, Sarai to Abram, "See, now the Lord has restrained me from bearing children." And so the Lord has made this promise, yet Sarai says, the Lord's restrained me. And so if God's going to fulfill the promise and I can't bear children, then what in the world is going on? And so Sarai did what a lot of us tend to do when we may be having a little bit of impatience, or may have a little bit of doubt, or a little bit of uncertainty about how God is going to fulfill his promises in our lives. And so she did what we often do, is and try to come up with her own solution. She took the situation in her own hands and was doing, I suppose, what she thought was best. And so she tells Abram, and she gets Abram and Hagar together, Hagar being the maidservant, and basically gives the green light and says, "Husband, go and be with this maidservant and have this child." Well, Hagar and Abram get together, and and Hagar conceives. And Sarai does not respond well to this. And the mistress Hagar became despised in her eyes. That's the end of verse number 4. And so Hagar goes off into the wilderness. The Lord ends up telling her to return. And the Lord blesses Hagar with the son named Ishmael. This is not the son of promise, but the Lord, he is the God who sees, verse number 13. And so that didn't work out all that well in regards to, we don't just see complete aspects of faith from Sarai in this moment. But in the next chapter, chapter 17, there is a renewal of this promise. And God said to Abraham, verse 15, "As for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her name Sarai, but Sarai shall be her name. And I will bless her and also give you a son by her. Then I will bless her, and she shall be a mother of nations. Kings of peoples shall be from her." For the first time, the promise to Abraham now specifically includes Sarah. I'm specifically mentioning how the Lord is not just going to bless Abraham as the father of many nations, but that Sarah herself is going to be a part of this, that she's going to be the mother of nations. And this is Abraham and Sarah, and they are going to be able to conceive. And so the classic response, verse 17, Abraham falls on his face and laughed in his heart. "Shall a child be born to a man who is 100 years old? And shall Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child?" And Abraham said to God, "Oh, that Ishmael might live before you." Verse 19, then God said, "No, Sarah, your wife, shall bear you a son, and you shall call his name Isaac. I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant, and with his descendants after him. And as for Ishmael, I have heard you. Behold, I have blessed him and will make him fruitful and will multiply him exceedingly." It wasn't that Ishmael was just completely disregarded, but this was going to be between Abraham and Sarah. It didn't make sense, but it was a promise that the Lord had given to them. And so we, as you see in chapter number 18, there's a situation here and in which verse number 9, they said to him, "Where is Sarah, your wife?" So he said, "Here in the tent." And he said, "I will certainly return to you according to the time of life. And behold, Sarah, your wife, will have a son." Verse 11, now Abraham and Sarah were old, well advanced in age. And Sarah had passed the age of childbearing. Therefore, here we go, Sarah herself laughed within herself, saying, "After I have grown old, shall I have pleasure, my Lord being old also?" And the Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh, saying, 'Shall I surely bear a child, since I am old?' Is anything," Genesis 18, verse 14, "is anything too hard for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return to you according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son." And in good old-fashioned husband-wife argument style, Sarah denied it, saying, "I did not laugh, for she was afraid." And the Lord said, "No, but you did, I did laugh." Is anything too hard for the Lord? Now, things are hard for us all the time. And I know the kiddos are about to go back to school within a week or two. And those of us that have finished school, we remember the hard classes and the easy classes. Some classes may have just come with ease, not much effort. easy A, no problem. Other classes may have been difficult, maybe because of the subject matter, maybe because of the teacher, and you work hard and you some way somehow find a way to get through it, and it may even take an extra time or two, an extra attempt or two to get it. But life is hard. And we find ourselves in situations, and it may not be the 100-year-old/90-year-old trying to conceive a child, but we find ourselves in situations all the time in which we're trying to ask the Lord, how is this going to work out? You've made your promises to us. I don't see how this is going to make sense. I don't see how this is going to work. And if we are not careful, we can become like Sarah, to a point where we start questioning, we start scheming, we start doubting, and we may even start laughing at what the Lord has promised to us. But one of the things that we've got to come to grips with is that in the same way the situation occurred here during the days of Abraham and Sarah, the same is true for us in that God works in his own time. He doesn't work on our timetable. He doesn't just do whatever we want when we want it. And sometimes God's will to unfold, God's plan to unfold, takes longer than we initially think that it will. But with God's time, it's always the right time. And God is, in his time, he will fulfill promises. Notice Genesis 21, verse number 1. And the Lord visited Sarah, as he had said. And the Lord did for Sarah as he had spoken. For Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age, and the set time of which God had spoken to him. And Abraham called the name of his son who was born to him, whose Sarah bore to him, Isaac. And then Abraham circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8 days old, as God had commanded. Now Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. And Sarah said, God has made me laugh, and all who hear will laugh with me. She also said, who would have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? For I have borne him a son in his old age. Is there anything too hard for God? Absolutely not. So no matter what difficulties you're facing in your life, no matter what challenges you're facing in your life, no matter what dilemmas, no matter what problems, it may seem as if there's no solution. It may seem as if there's no way out. There's no light at the end of the tunnel. But understand that there is nothing too hard for God. But also in understanding the fact that there's nothing too hard for God, also connect Genesis 21, verse number 2, in understanding that God has his set times in which he's going to act. And that set time may come sooner than we had expected. It may come a whole lot later than we had expected. In other words, what Sarah needed and what we need is patience. Patience for God to do the hard work. Patience for his time to arrive. Patience involves waiting, and patience sometimes includes suffering. But as we're waiting and as we're suffering, we're keeping the faith. We don't know how it's all going to work out, but we know that God will work it out because there is nothing too hard for God. So be patient, learn to wait, and understand that suffering is a part of our lives. And so as we patiently wait on the Lord, as we persevere through our suffering, we're going to come out at the end of this as men and women of faith. It's going to be a roller coaster at times, but let's put our seatbelt on. Let's keep the faith and understand that there is nothing too hard for God.